Hi, good morning, and thank you to the organizers of Botany 2021 and the organizers of this symposium. My name is Liliana Catinas, and I will present two tribes of the subfamily Muticioidae, the tribes Nasaubie and Mutisie, starting with the tribe Mutisie. So now I will share the screen. Okay, I will start with an introduction to the Nasaubie. The diagnostic features of Nasaubie are corollas bilabiate, style branches truncate, crowned by elongate papillae, anthers longly caudate, pollen microachinate with exine bilayer, ectosexin and endosexin columellate. The members of Nasaubie have a neotropical distribution with a major concentration in the Andes and in Patagonia. The tribe comprises 26 genera and around 300 species, and it is mostly constituted by genera, by monotypic genera, although there are also genera with many species, such as Acurtia with 80, or Nasaubia with 38, or Trixis with also 38. Nasaubia is a monophyletic tribe. All phylogenetic analysis with morphological or molecular data, or with different markers, show the monophyly of the tribe. You can see here the Nasaubie and the sister Mutisie and Onoceridae. Regarding the diagnostic characters of Nasaubie, one of the main diagnostic characters is the corolla. In the Nasaubie, with very few exceptions, all the florets of the capitula are bilabiate. A typical bilabial corolla is constituted by an inner bifid lip and an outer tridentate lip. It is very usual that this outer lip is extending, is long, and thus it is radiating in the marginal florets. Very few genera in the tribe have also this type of tubular florets. This photograph of one species of Polyachirus show the inner lip with the two units and the outer lip, and show also the orientation of these lips, also always the inner lip oriented to the center of the capitulum and the outer lip to the outer part of the capitulum. Other of the main characters of the tribe is the style. With very few exceptions, like this, the members of Nasaubie have this style with the branches truncate at the apex and crowned by a tuft of sweeping or pollen collector hairs. You can see this also in this photograph of one species of Leuceria. And the inner surface is completely covered by stigmatic papillae. This is the fertile part of the style. And this is not only, of course, in the Nasaubie, but also in all the basal grades of the family, different from the tribes in the upper part of the family tree that have usual two lines of stigmatic papillae. The anthers are prolonged in an apical appendage and has two long tails. They are longly caudate. The pollen grains are microacinate. That means that it has these very short, small spines in the surface. And if you make a cut of the pollen grain, you will see the wall of the pollen grain, which is called the exine. It is bilayer. It's constituted by two layers, the ectosexin and the endosexin. And both have columns. They are columellate. Just to see some examples of genera species of the Nasauvia, many plant communities in Patagonia are dominated, for example, by species of Nasauvia. In this case, you see in the photograph Nasauvia glomerulosa. Some of the genera of Nasauvia have capitula groups in capitula, which is called the secondary capitula, secondary heads, pseudocephalia, syncephalia. They are all synonyms of this structure. It occurs, for example, in Polyachirus and Moscaria, where if you made a transection of this inflorescence, you will see that each capitulum is constituted only by two florets, and these florets gather again in a capituliform secondary inflorescence. It could be an adaptation for pollination. One genus, the genus Leuceria, most of the species of Leuceria have this particular filary disposition. Well, you see in the photograph the outer filary and the inner filary, and in the middle of them, florets. These inner filaries can have this disposition with the concave part oriented to the center of the capitulum, or with the concave part oriented to the outer part of the capitula, or also oriented 90 degrees. So they made what is called a compartmentalization of the capitula. As I previously told, there are many monotypic genera in the tribe. This is the case of Crisia. And in general, these monotypics have very restricted distributions. On the other hand, there are other genera with many species and that are widespread. For example, the case of Trixis, the genus Trixis, which has a neotropical distribution. Let's go now to another tribe of the subfamily Muticioide, the tribe Muticiae. Some of the diagnostic features of the Muticiae are the corollas could be all bilabiate in the capitulum or can be combined with other types of corollas. The style branches are dorsally papillose and the papillae are distributed above the branches bifurcation point. The anthers are longly caudate and the papus is homomorphic. And in a while, I will go to each one of these features. Regarding the distribution, the members of Muticiae are distributed in all continents except Europe and Antarctica, but are mostly concentrated in the Americas. The tribe comprises 15 genera and around 230 species, and it has a balanced composition of genera with many species, such as Ketantera with 30 species, Captalia with 40, Muticia with 63. Also genera with less than 20 species, such as Adenocaulon, Brachyclados, Lemnitzia, and genera with one or two species, with one species, Lulia empaquilena, with two species, Ambisperma perdicium. The tribe is monophyletic. The phylogenetic analysis performed with different molecular markers and with different species show the monophyly of the tribe. Here you see some representants of the Mutisiae and the sister tribes, Nasaubiae and Onoceridae. Regarding the diagnostic characters, we found again here the bilabiate corollas with this typical inner lip and outer lip. And in the case of the Mutisiae, all the florets of the capitulum could be bilabiate, or in general, they are combined with other types of corollas. These other types involve ligulate corollas, true ray, filiform, tubular bilabiate. This is a photograph of Gerbera that shows a capitulum constituted by three types of florets from the outer part of the capitulum to the inner part of the capitulum. You have this ligulate floret with this very extended lip. You see here, these are the marginal. The central florets or intermediate florets are bilabiate. You can see here the two inner lips and the outer lip. And the central florets are tubular bilabiate. The members of Mutisiae have a style with branches that can be short or long. These branches are papillose, usually above the bifurcation point of the branches. And the inner surface, in the same way that the Nasaubiae, are completely covered by stigmatic papillae. You see here in this photograph of one species of Mutisiae, the dorsal side of the branch with long papillae. These are the collector papillae, and the inner part of the branch, the fertile part with the stigmatic papillae, which are shorter regarding the outer papillae. The anthers are similar to the Nasaubiae. They have this apical appendage and have long tails. These tails could be glabrous or papillose. In this case, in the photograph, which is a species of Trichocline, shows two papillose anthers. Another of the characters is the papus. The papus is homomorphic. It means that it is constituted by the same type of bristles. And this is a character that allows distinction of Mutisiae from Onoceridae, the other tribe of the subfamily, where the papus is heteromorphic because it has two types of bristles. Here, this is a mature capitula with the fruits ready for the dispersion, but you still can see here some florets in a species of Captalia. Well, to know some characteristics of genera of the Mutisiae, some members are common components of the Alto Andean flora. This is Paquilena, and this is one species of Quetantera. They are adapted to the harsh environment of the Andes. The plants are usually very short in stature, and the leaves are tightly disposed, sometimes very pubescent. This is not the case, but it's very usual that they are very pubescent. And in general, oppressed to the soil. Some genera, such as Adenocaulon, have particular mechanisms for dispersion. You can see here the fruits with this particular glandular hairs. This is a photograph, a microscope photograph of one of these hairs. They are very sticky and they can adhere to the feathers of the birds or the legs of the birds. Very good mechanism for dispersion. There are also some genera like Leibnizia in the tribe Mutisiae that are dimorphic. That means that there is a generation of Chasmogamous capitula. It means that the capitula open and receive the pollinators and they have access to the style and the anthers. And then in the same year, this generation is followed by another generation, but this time of Cleistogamous capitula. The capitula remain closed and there is auto-pollination. So it's a very efficient reproductive system that offer the cross-pollination and the auto-pollination. There are, of course, a lot of genera. This is a case of Mutisiae with hummingbird pollination. You can see in this case the adaptation to this type of pollination, the showy flowers, the tubular form of the capitulum. There are at the base of the style nectaries. And this is not only the case of Mutisiae, but there are other members of the tribe and also of the subfamily that are adapted to this type of pollination. Also, it is combined with bee pollination and the regular types of pollination, but it is very characteristic of the tribe. And I'm sure that you know this herbera. There are many ornamentals. In this case, it has a commercial value in the case of herbera. They are very common in the greenhouses and nursery stores. So, well, I hope that you have enjoyed this talk about these two tribes of the subfamily Mutisiae. Thank you very much. Thank you.